Mr. President, welcome. We want to go through, talk about the presidential debates that you participated in, and also get some general comments. First, 1980. There were two debates. You debated John Anderson, then you debated President Carter. What kind of preparation did you go through for the Jimmy Carter debate?
Well, we had come back for the final days here and had a place down in Virginia that had been loaned to us, a home down there, and so we could be campaigning more here in the East and all. And yes, we would get together and they'd throw questions at me and so forth, our people would, and we had several days of this, and I thought it helped to do that.
This was the time where Gene Kirkpatrick, George Will, David Stockman played the various roles.
Yeah, Dave most of the time, if they were doing things like that, would play Carter.
President Carter said that his strategy going into that debate was to show the people that you were not that well informed on national security and foreign affairs policy. Did you know that going in, that was his target?
No, I didn't really know that, but I think he was a little off base in that, because as governor, first of all, I was governor of a state that, if it were a nation, would be the seventh ranking economic power in the world, California. But also, President Nixon had asked me on a number of occasions to represent him on trips abroad. And I had been in 18 countries and actually meeting with the heads of state of 18 countries while I was still a governor. And I think that I had a pretty good insight into our foreign policy and those foreign affairs.
That debate is remembered for several things. One of them is your line, "There you go again." It was about Medicare. It came up in a discussion about Medicare and whether you had favored it or not early on.
Oh, yes.
And you said, "There you go again."
Yeah. Well, at that time, some of the people who were proposing this, and I wasn't against the Medicare bill that finally came along, but some of the people that were proposing this, it was obvious that they, in reality, wanted socialized medicine. And I knew a little bit about socialized medicine as it's practiced in a number of other countries. And one country, I won't name it, but for example, beyond a certain age, people requiring surgery in that country were put on waiting lists. The government was hoping that before they got around to their operation, they wouldn't need it. They wouldn't be there anymore.
I see. Was the "There you go again" a line that just came to you spontaneously, or was it something that you had worked on?
No, it just seemed to be the thing to say in what he was saying up there, and because it was, to me, it felt kind of repetitious, something we'd heard before.
The other thing that came out of that debate was President Carter's statement about his daughter Amy, and that he had talked to his daughter about what the big issue was, and she had said nuclear proliferation, nuclear weapons, nuclear disarmament. What did you, when he said that, if you were standing there on the stage, were you aware of the fact that he had made a terrible mistake?
It seemed to me he had, because the whole thing sounded, and I think you could hear, almost feel an attitude from the audience on it, that the president was going to make a major policy based on what a child told him. And I'm sure he didn't have that in mind, but that's the way it came out. And I was prepared to say to the people, I'd promise them I wouldn't ask my kids what I should do.
Yeah, that's how you felt that night. I mean, you knew that when he said it. Generally, how important do you think that debate was to your having defeated President Carter?
I think there were some things. As a matter of fact, I think a very telling line was at the very end of the debate when I told the people that if they believed they were better off than they were 4 years ago, then they had no other choice but to vote for my opponent. But if they thought they weren't better off and that there were things that could be done, I'd like to offer myself as the candidate for their selection. And I did feel that there were very definite shortcomings that, you know, we were being told by our government before that election that we should lower our sights, that never again would we live at the level that we lived as Americans, that the world was different now, and that we must be willing to tighten our belts and not have the things we used to have. Well, my philosophy and my belief was that it was a long way for us to go in improving what we had ever known before, that this country of ours was a country of constant improvement. And so I thought that, well, what my whole approach was based on the promise of a better America.
Let's move to 1984. You debated Walter Mondale twice. The first debate, Louisville, Kentucky. The consensus afterward, Mr. President, was that you were tired, didn't do that well, et cetera. Do you agree with that? Were you tired?
No, it wasn't tired, but I was overtrained. We then, and being there in office and all, and everyone available, I want to tell you, I just had more facts and figures poured at me for weeks before than anyone could possibly sort out and use. And I called it overtraining. When I got there, I realized that I was racking my brain so much for facts and figures on whatever subject we were talking about that I knew I didn't do well. And the second debate, I wasn't overtrained.
Mm-hmm. And you feel you pulled that one out, no question about that one, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you remember your line about, because the age, the first one, the age factor was raised as a result of that.
And I couldn't believe that question when it came at me from that press board that was there and asked me that question about my age, and was that going to be an issue in the campaign? And I thought that had to be turned around, and that was when I said there's no way that just for political purposes I would take advantage of my opponent's youth and inexperience.
Was that one you were laying for?
I mean, I never thought about it coming out. That was really off the top of my head.
Yeah. And in you did not do the kind of preparation at all for the second one you did for the first one, right?
I felt we'd learned our lesson.
Finally, Mr. President, let me ask you about a debate that was crucial in your political career, even though it wasn't. It was during a primary. It was in New Hampshire, in 1980 with George Bush. And tell me that story about the microphone and all of that, because it was considered very important, as you know.
The newspaper was not allowed to finance this debate. And we volunteered to fund it and put up the money that it took to put this thing on. Then I invited all the other candidates in our ticket to come and felt that it should be the whole thing. Well, the paper had wanted it 1-2, and they continued and with George's team to say that it should only be 2. Well, I invited the others to come, and they appeared, and they were there on the platform. And the people in charge of the paper were saying, you know, that they had to leave, that it was just going to be the two of us. And I was opposing this. And one of the newspaper men who was kind of honchoing the whole debate on his microphone called on the man in charge of the microphones and told him, with all the audience listening, to shut my microphone off so that I couldn't be heard. And I couldn't resist. I said, Mr. Green, I paid for this microphone. And got quite a laugh and a reaction from the audience because they knew that how it was good we were doing it.
You know, there's some people who suggested at the time and since that showed that had a lot to do with your winning that primary.
Well,
do you agree with that?
Well, I've heard reports to that effect. The laugh from the audience was definitely on my side, and I was kind of mad.
All right. Mr. President, thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Pleasure.